Welcome to Going Through the Motions, where justice is served with a twist of drama and a dash of intrigue. In this high-stakes arena, where truth and lies collide, we follow the riveting cases, the impassioned arguments, and the relentless pursuit of justice. Join retired Special Agent Sean McDonough as he delves deep into the legal battleground, where every verdict has consequences, and every motion sets the stage for gripping tales of law and order. This is Going Through the Motions with Sean McDonough.
Is there that any evidence was planted?
Are you serious?
Good evening, everyone. Hope everyone can hear me. This is Sean McDonough, 702 on the East Coast down here in Naples, Florida. I hope everyone is having a great day so far. This is truly amazing because 2 weeks ago today, I had no show. This was not even on the radar for me at all. And what an incredible time to be here because we have the Karen Reed case going on. We're gonna have an incredible, absolutely incredible show tonight. And before getting into it, I wanna kind of set up how this whole thing came about. It was last summer, towards the end of July, early August. I was talking to Aiden, as a matter of fact, about what we're going to do with the groups. There was a little controversy. And all of a sudden, I get this weird phone call. And I said, hey, I'll have to get you back. I don't know what's going on. It was this very strange phone call. And I had to be directed to different, you know, areas to call in. Don't call in. Press this button. Don't press that button. It was a complete tradecraft. I recognize it from my time with DEA, working with high levels confidential sources at the highest level. So I knew the route and I said, who the hell's putting me through this rabbit hole? Make a long story short, I met these individuals. We were talking for a very long time. And we tried to get this show together through different mediums, but it never came to fruition. However, 2 weeks ago today, I had no show. And I decided at 3 o'clock in the morning, on Friday morning, 2 weeks ago, to say, I'm going to get this show going. I'm not going to be restricted by anyone else. And I got on the YouTube, like most of you people know, I got onto the YouTube. I learned how to do stream that. I learned how to set my whole other channel up. And by the time 7 o'clock came around in the evening, I had over 1,000 subscribers, which is truly amazing. And here we are on the eve of my 2 week anniversary. I got close to 5,000 subscribers, which I truly attribute to all you people out there. So anyways, as most of you people know, I put out some clips. I set this up last night. I wasn't sure if we were going to get this going or not, but I guarantee this is going to be an incredible, absolutely incredible show tonight. It's going to be very controversial, that I can tell you, but we're going to kick it off with a person that most of you Bostonians should know. All you people in Baltimore, all right, Montreal Expos. I'm going to bring in Dan Duquette, all right, to the stage here. And Dan, how you doing, my friend? Can you hear me?
Good, Sean. How are you? Thanks for having me on. Yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me? No, I can't hear you now, buddy.
All right, so I cut myself off. How about now, Dan?
Yeah, I can hear you good. Yes, I can hear you. Is my mic not working? I can't hear you.
Dan, how about now?
There, yeah, that's good.
Okay, beautiful. Okay, good. All right, Dan's good. Okay, very good. Dan, I'm sorry about that. There's always a little bit of a glitch here. I can't believe it. Look at the background. I feel like I'm at the park already.
And, well, that's opening day in Baltimore a few years ago. And I think that's the flag that they had in the harbor when Francis Scott Key wrote the national anthem there.
That's truly amazing. So, Dan, for the people who don't really know you at all, it's kind of hard. Can you just give us a little introduction to yourself, who you are, where you're from, and how'd you get to meet a guy like me?
Probably because you're from Fort Myers, right?
Yeah, right.
No, I've been a baseball executive most of my life. I grew up in Western Massachusetts in Dalton, Mass. And Dalton, of course, is famous for the Crane Paper Company. That's where they make the paper upon which U.S. currency has been printed on for years. And now they make paper for several countries around the globe. But anyway, my grandfather worked there. My dad was a school superintendent. And from there, I went to Amherst College, got into Major League Baseball through Harry Dalton, who was an Amherst College guy from West Springfield, great executive, built the great Oriole teams of the late 60s and early 70s. What a great baseball man he was. And then from there, I went to Montreal, I ran their player development operation, got an opportunity to be the GM there. I got a chance to come home to my dream job and run the Red Sox, and I succeeded Lou Gorman there. And built up a good farm system for them and helped them win the 2004 World Series with a lot of the players that I had there. And then after that, I went and I built a baseball academy back in Western Mass, right next to Dalton and Hinsdale, Mass, and also founded the Israel Baseball League. Since I left the Orioles, I've been doing consulting in sports and entertainment and medical technology and real estate. And that's how I got involved with this project here with Nick Fiorillo in Godspace on a consulting basis. And I've taken on a much larger role recently as we try to get the Connecticut Data Corridor funded and built.
That's awesome, Dan. And I got to tell you, when you just said 2004, I just got goose pimples because I had just arrived from Peru. I was my first summer here in Naples. And like you said, up in Fort Myers to have the team playing up in spring training in Fort Myers. Now, we do have a little connection. I went to college at Westfield State back in the early 70s, mid 70s. And one of the famous baseball players, Carlton Steele from Westfield, was signed by the Red Sox. And anyways, but I always remember the 2003 series when, you know, with the Yankees and that whole thing. I was on a flight going back from Miami to Peru. And by the time I got off the plane, the Sox had lost. I said, oh, God. But that 2004 series, you know, as a kid, 1967, I could tell you everything about all that. Mike Gaines was a second. Rico Petrocelli, George Scott, Joe Foy, Reggie, Kyle, Tony C, Jim Lomborg. I mean, it was just amazing. And then to fail. But that 2004, I mean, come on. That was epic. Three wins in a row against the Yankees. That had to be the biggest. It was just amazing.
Absolutely. Yeah, that was a great thrill for so many people, right? I mean, four generations of my family watched the Red Sox. My grandmother used to stay up late at night to watch the games on the coast from her living room seat. And, of course, my dad was a big Ted Williams fan and my godmother. They absolutely loved the Red Sox. And we didn't quite get through knocking on the door during the time that I was there, but we got the team close. And 2003 was a heartbreaker. The AFB game with a home run off my good friend Tim Wakefield. God rest his soul.
Oh, God rest his soul.
But they got through in 2004, and You know, that made a lot of people happy, and that accomplished one of my lifelong goals that I had, was to help the Red Sox win a World Series championship. And I was grateful that I got a chance to see him do that.
Of course, you got that beautiful ring. That 2004 ring was absolutely beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. Well, that's great to go back to, you know, into memory lane and everything like that. But Dan, please tell us, how did you get into this epic story with yourself and Nick Fiorillo?
Well, I started working with Nick back in 2022 when I became aware that he needed some help on a consulting basis, that he was having trouble with some of his lenders. And I've been with him through this process. And I have to tell you that I'm not proud of my home state, Massachusetts, and what I've seen in terms of the law enforcement and the judicial system, the courts, and some of the behaviors I've seen. And I've been following your show with more than limited interest recently, because we got involved in following the Karen Reed saga. And I'm sad to say that the same playbook that this group is using to attempt to frame Karen Reed is the same playbook that the group has been running on Nick Fiorillo and Godspace going on 3 years now.
See that?
It's just kind of sad that we see the law enforcement weaponized against citizens. Innocent citizens who have their civil rights trampled. And that's really what this fight is all about. It's about fighting for the civil rights of the people. The people in Massachusetts deserve a lot better than they're getting from their public servants, you know, the citizens of Norfolk County, citizens of Boston, Harwich, all across the state. You know, if the government can prosecute an innocent party like Karen Reed, and police state a family like I watch with the Fiorillos, who's a tech executive, and Nick's just trying to sabotage, or just trying to build a community for data, and they use the political system to sabotage that. You know, what's next for the other law-abiding citizens in Massachusetts? Who's next on that hit list from our judicial system, our law enforcement? Thankfully, we've had some real heroes come in and shine the light on the bad that's been going on. Alan Jackson, I am so impressed with what he's been doing. Josh Levy's doing good work. The FBI is helping straighten things out, and we're hopeful that they continue on the good work that they're doing in Massachusetts.
That is awesome. So I've seen a lot of people in the chat. By the way, we're 5 minutes into the show. We have over 1,000 people watching us, which is really incredible. It's a testament to all these people who are following us, and to yourself, Dan, and further on we get into Nick. And so what I'd like to do, a lot of people are asking, how does Dan Duquette crisscross into the Karen Reed case? And I don't want to say anything because I've been holding back. But you have a great story, and please tell the people in the audience how Boston's own 2004 Red Sox World Series champs get involved with people, players in the Karen Reed case.
Well, I've been trying to help Godspace and Nick find the right structure for his company to develop the Connecticut Data Corridor, because that's a very important asset for the entire country, right? The medical, the technology, the financial that runs between New York and Boston, the insurance companies, they would all benefit from it. The people of Connecticut would certainly benefit from the labor that would be brought there. And over the course of this journey, if you will, with Nick and I've seen a number of unhonorable things done to Nick along the way, to try and frame him for crimes that he didn't commit, and to try to charge him to limit his effectiveness as a CEO in developing this corridor. And that's really what my interest has been. And like I said, I've seen a lot of the same plays from the playbook of the people in Massachusetts, some in law enforcement, some in the courts, used against Nick Fiorillo and Godspace as they're attempting to use to frame Karen Reed.
Right. Now, I know your time is limited tonight with us, and I just really, when we spoke last night after my show, I was blown away because you basically recounted a story that you had told me, and I just said, I cannot believe this. And if you could just, you know, as much as you can, just tell me about what we talked about.
Well, in June of 2022, the opposition to Godspace, they forced Nick's wife, Tracy Fiorillo, into a deposition at the law firm of Gesmer Updegrove. And during the deposition that she was forced to do, Nick was trying to shield his wife from this because they were just trying to intimidate Nick and his family into giving up the Godspace company to the lenders and other executives. And Nick was just trying to defend his wife from witness intimidation at the Gesmer Updegrove office. And he was assaulted by the attorney that was cross-examining him, Kevin Peters.
In the hearing, in the deposition?
In the hearing and the deposition. Nick's wife, she was under so much pressure. She had a cardiac event and she passed out. And Nick was attending to her. And Kevin Peters came across the table and grabbed Nick by the coat and started to assault him. And Kevin actually admitted the assault in the magistrate's hearing. But after that event, I was on phone calls with Detective Carl Dugall of the Boston Police Department on Precinct 1. Uh-huh. And I listened to Nick file in deep detail a police report and a criminal complaint against Kevin Peters for the assault which he initiated during the deposition of Nick's wife in the law office of Gesmer Updegrove. I heard an audio recording of this assault, which was very instructive and quite unsettling. And I listened to Nick give his account of the event to Carl Dugall on a couple of different phone calls.
So in other words, Nick presented a complaint to the Boston Police Department, and our good friend Carl Dugall, right, was the detective that basically took the report.
He took the report, but what we found out was when we went to the magistrate hearing was that Detective Dugall didn't file the report. He put it in the wastebasket. He trash canned the criminal complaint that Nick and Tracy Fiorillo filed against Kevin Peters, who assaulted them during the deposition. And Tracy went to Mass General Hospital for 3 days after this event. They wouldn't have kept her in Mass General unless there was a significant cardiac event. That's the best hospital in the world.
Absolutely.
And she also went down to the Boston Police Department Precinct 1, and she also spoke to the detectives. But on a release from the hospital, he threw her testimony away too.
That's absolutely incredible. Do you think, what would you surmise the motive for a Boston police detective to do this?
Well, it became clearer to us. We went to a magistrate hearing, and after the magistrate hearings, the BPD filed a warrant, which I felt was under false pretenses, for Nick Fiorillo's arrest for an assault and battery on Kevin Peters.
Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. They did a reverse. In other words, instead of Nick and his wife being the complainants, they end up being the defendants?
Yes, right. And Kevin Peters in the magistrate hearing actually testified that he grabbed Nick, and that qualified as an assault, as I understand it, under the law. and he admitted so much in the hearing. But they filed a warrant, I thought, under false pretenses for Nick's arrest. And on the very same day that the Fiorillos were being assaulted by Kevin Peters, and Detective Dugall was working on a plan to frame Mr. Fiorillo, the law firm Gesmer Updegrove then held a meeting in the same office where the Fiorillo family was assaulted in an unlawful attempt to remove Mr. Fiorillo as the manager of one of the Godspace properties.
So that's what I'm interested in. So in other words, you guys were in negotiations for this venture, this company that Nick and yourself wanted to get off the ground, right? And these people tried to steal it right out from under you, right?
Several times. But, you know, the actions of the Boston Police Department in trash canning the complaint from a family that they were trying to intimidate as witnesses who were really trying to defend their property and their family, and they were assaulted by an attorney during a deposition. That there's something not right about that. No. And then to have the Boston police file a counter complaint and to trash can the complaint, even when Peters the assailant admitted it, you know that there's something rotten in Boston.
And of course, there's tape of the actual deposition that clearly shows that Nikki's wife was assaulted. I mean, that's just.
There's an audio tape. I'm not sure what happened to the videotape.
Okay. Wow.
So somebody's got their hands on that, or they disposed of that. Right. We didn't see the videotape, but we have a very persuasive audio tape, which gives you a really good idea about what went on during that deposition and the assault.
Right. So how was the charges disposed of, or have they been disposed of in this particular manner?
Well, they haven't been disposed of yet. In December of 22, they tried to get Mr. Fiorillo to come in and to dispose of the warrant just prior to Christmas. Actually, it was similar to what they did to Turtle Boy down there when they brought him in before Christmas and then put him in jail. Mr. Fiorillo decided to transfer the case out of the jurisdiction of the BPD so that he wouldn't subject himself and his family to any more of this nonsense.
Right. That's amazing. Wow. I mean, I'll tell you, you've clearly followed the Karen Reed case and my reporting on it and blogs and all these things that we were doing in Facebook, but you can see the parallel, right? We know that Carl Dougal shows up to all these hearings. We don't really understand what his purpose is other than he claims he was a very good friend of John O'Keefe. Yet he has to have taken a look at this evidence, and he completely denies to comment or even debate me on the evidence. But I'm just completely blown away by this story. I always have been, but I didn't realize the connection you and Nick had to Carl Dougal. And it's been this whole process has been incredible. So Dan, I want to bring Nick on because this is the man we were waiting on here. And here he is. This is Mr. Nick Fiorillo. And Nikki, like I said, you heard us in the beginning. We've been at this for a while now, right? I talk to you all the time, right? And Nick, it's a testament. Listen, it's truly a testament to have a class A type guy like Dan Duquette with you. Okay. Now, I lined this up as that this was going to be a very controversial, right, interview. All right. But before we get into the meat and everything, let's give us a little background on who you are, where you come from, and how this whole thing evolved for you.
Sure. Sean, I want to thank you for having, the fortitude to get out on the front of this thing and really tell the Massachusetts residents and the rest of we the people throughout the country about the massive corruption that has been roiling Massachusetts for probably a half century. And it's quite obvious as, we have some of the greatest hits of all time in corruption. I take us back to the Roman Catholic clergy abuse scandal. We're going to talk a little bit about the best and high times of the Winter Hill Gang and Whitey Bulger and the trial of the century that never happened. Right. And also getting into the overtime scandal. These massive types of corruption have roiled our state since the 50s. And it has now, it as though the everything has aligned perfectly to expose the corruption that really started, in the beginning of our country's history. I mean, this is where the Civil War started, the shot heard around the world. Today, it's not civil war that, with arms, although, we would talk about Mr. Soros and all that stuff, but it is about the media and the fail of media locally to not tell or inform the truth of what's actually happening in the Karen Reed case. It is wild. So I'm going to go back to, I'm a real estate developer from Shrewsbury, Massachusetts. I went to St. John's. I later graduated from Northeastern University. In my earlier years, some of you guys may remember in your 40s and 50s, I was the founder and created the Palladium nightclub in Worcester, Massachusetts.
Whoa.
Yep. From there, I went on into real estate development. And early on, this will all start to come out. I was also a real estate developer, and I found myself on the other side of a large-scale loan sharking ring in the early 2010 to 2012 range that involved a lot of the same characters that are still involved now here in the corruption of Massachusetts. I'm going to take credit today first publicly for the prior removal of Kenneth Kaiser, the former Boston special agent in charge. The individual that was running the front for back then George Soros was David G. Massad and his companion or compadre, Marcello Malegni, in a large-scale loan sharking ring. And it was found out after this company forced me into bankruptcy that Kenneth Kaiser, the director of the Office of the FBI and director of organized crime in the United States, was taking kickbacks from David G. Massad and Marcello Malegni and a faction of the organized crime Winter Hill gang. He was removed, leading up to rebuilding my real estate and getting back into real estate. I find myself getting involved in developing traditional self-storage under the GOT space self-storage brands. We have some self-storage interest in Beverly, Massachusetts, Gloucester, Massachusetts, under the Life Storage brand. We developed Cube Smarts. I'm one of the co-founders of True Storage. And we got into digital infrastructure, which is basically just a storage of what we would call back in the heydays, server farms, and putting up a development in the New England area to build out a corridor of a massive 10 million square foot digital infrastructure pipeline, like Dan said, between New York and Boston, that will house the next 100 years of our nation's deepest secrets, financials, education, medical, tech, innovation, compute, supercompute, and quantum computing, and the ChatGPT machine learning tools to help autonomous vehicles. And America continue to control and be in control of a democratic free world, being the thing that really makes the world go round is the money and the financials. Being our campus in Wallingford will house in the next 3 to 5 years the exchanges that are set up and we're operating out of Wall Street. If America can continue to hold and transact a financial trade in front of the rest of the world's exchanges, we can continue to monetize the free world and spread it to other nations and keep it from flipping to a communist state.
Right. So Nick, real quick, I because it piqued my interest. How's a guy like you from Shrewsbury, Central Mass, go from the Palladium to self-storage to get into this massive data? How do you transition to something that huge? How did that happen?
So I would think if you dream it, it will happen. I had a vision, back in the heyday of bringing, world-class entertainment to Central Mass, which we accomplished. The Palladium is still there, one of the great concert halls in New England. And getting into self-storage, I saw a need to basically reinvent self-storage and make it something that is more obtainable for everybody. So we launched a self-storage platform and we set up a company to do that. And then hearing about the next wave of real estate. So data centers are basically just boxes similar to what you would see in Amazon distribution centers. And the boxes are built with more stringent classifications to survive, I wouldn't say a Patriot missile attack, but any type of terrorist attack or small types of artillery to house what actually makes the world go round, and that's data and information and of which it transacts. It was an easy segue, 2.5-3 years ago, to understand where the next wave of development would be coming, and being it's just now. What goes inside these big boxes is servers. And this is where we watch TV. This is how, you are on YouTube and Facebook and Netflix, and having such a centralized nexus of data compute power, it's the only place on Earth that will basically set up New England to be the CPU or the computer chip that will run the rest of the world. So if you had a computer at home, you know, there's a, you know, back in the day, there was a Pentium chip, or I was fortunate enough to speak with Mike Dell today. There might be a Dell compute chip inside of a computer. Well, this is the compute chip for the rest of the globe being ready to be deployed in Connecticut. The land is worth tens of billions of dollars that we were able to entitle, working a very unique situation with the state of Connecticut, the governor, the economic development director, David Lehman, along with the towns in Connecticut on direct fiber. And we put together the most competitive data tax incentive bill, or incentive bill since like the New Deal, or like when Rockefeller rolled out the railroads and connected the West and the East Coast together. This data corridor is the next 100 years of America's ability to control the world, to bring democracy, truth, justice. And why everyone's fighting about it, and this is who our adversaries that no one really wants to talk about, it's actually our adversaries are backed up by George Soros, the Biden administration. The Bulger family's a partner in this. Hunter Biden was partners and still is partners with the Bulger family, and Obama over at Martha's Vineyard. And it's none of what I'm telling you guys is made up or untrue. You know, it's been covered in the media, and their attempts to kill me, to take control at any cost, to frame me, is the same tactics that they did in the Karen Reed frame, to take control of this, because they want to rule the world and control and bend reality and hide the truth of corruption. Sure. And what is the corruption? It is what has been running the country from Massachusetts since they put RFK, well, JFK in office. Unfortunately, no one wants to talk about it, but it's the corrupt Massachusetts State Police, the Massachusetts secret courts, the FBI. We have the most notorious FBI office in the history of the country. Paul Rico is one of the great ones, John Connolly, and now James Michael Doyle will go down in history as the most corrupt FBI agent that is now a CIA operative. And their attempts to take control of this $100 billion project, Brian Albert was the guy that was hunting me.
So before we get to that, I want to just bring something up. I know you have, you have a computer chip in your brain. I know you do. Thousands of phone calls with you. I know. How did you meet the gentleman? How does Dan fit into this a little bit better? I mean, you got this whole project going. Hundreds of millions of dollars in that, right?
It's insane. So what I would say is the same way that you're on here and you're informing Massachusetts, we the people of Massachusetts, where it all started. Right. It really is. There's no explanation. It's divine intervention. And there are so many stories, if you will afford us the opportunity over the next couple of weeks to lay out, there are one in a billion that odds that continue to repeat themselves over and over again in the coincidence of how we find Karen Reed, poor John O'Keefe, and Brian Alberts, and him running the op to cover up a murder and then frame Reed, and then what he was doing in the fall of 2021 for the deep state that was attempting to take control of our company. We're on this chat right now tonight to inform Massachusetts, that will hope then inform the country and onto the world, that we the people will not stand for corruption, will not stand for lies, will not stand for any more nonsense. We're not fools in Massachusetts. We know what's going on. Everybody knows Karen Reed's innocent.
Of course.
But for some reason, the local papers, the Boston Globe, Dan's former employer, the Boston Herald, all I do is point your listeners and viewers to the photos they would put up there about innocent Karen Reed attempting to make her look like a villain when they themselves knew she was innocent. Ted Daniels is compromised in this situation.
Right. So let me give you a quick question, Nikki, real quick. I just want to get this because it's come up several times. Just please explain to us, how does Dan fit in?
You got to get
to that part.
That's what I was saying. It's a miracle, an absolute miracle.
All right, so bring it to the table. I need to hear it.
Okay, So Dan had a friend that this will segue right into a completely out of control wild story about secret CIA operatives in my houses in Nantucket and Harwichport. But Dan had a friend, excuse me, that was looking to get married at the Witchmere Harbor Club.
Oh, wow.
In Witchmere, down in Harwichport.
Right.
And his friend had rented our house. I have vacation rentals, and this is during the summer. My wife and I and children will go into one of our guest houses, and we would rent out this portfolio of homes. And during the process, it started to bubble up across, you know, the inner workings of Massachusetts that I was under attack, and the house that I was I had rented to Dan's friend was up for foreclosure. So they had a big wedding party, you know, at the Witchmere Harbor, and the friend was having their, you know, their rehearsal dinner, and they rented the house for the weekend, and he showed up at my house, and he met me, and I explained what was going on with this attack by George Soros and Thomas O'Neill and all this ridiculous stuff that was happening to the company as they attempted to extort control over it, and he was blown away. And he said, I have to introduce you to my friend. And when he rattled off Dan Duquette's name, I almost fell over. Goosebumps were on top of me. And I said, right. Well, if anyone could help me rebuild my company, the guy that brought the Red Sox to the dynasty it was, he could rebuild my company. I then meet Dan Duquette a few days later, and we begin to map out a plan to expose the deep state and the evil that was attempting to take over the company, and then, you know, build this $100 billion data project. As soon as Dan showed up, it was all hell that broke loose.
Okay, so that's great. So Dan, real quick, I know you have a time frame. So you meet Nikki, right? Now we're talking deep state, we're talking about all that stuff. Back then, were you kind of a deep state type guy, or you meet Nick and you have this meshing of this complete friendship? Tell me how.
Well, I was attracted to it because I was really impressed with Nick's intelligence and his fight. And I have a lot of respect for St. John's guys, too, by the way.
There you go.
The football coach there is a good friend of mine. But anyway, Nick had a very compelling story, and this is a huge economic opportunity. And it's really for the good of the United States. It's really for the good of the country. And it's a project that you could really see. If you put together the right team, you could make this happen. And I appreciated Nick inviting me to work with him. I'm disappointed we've come across so much corruption and unlawful behavior during the course of it. But we're almost on the other side where we can get to the point and develop this vision for everyone's benefit.
It's truly amazing. And so I just want to touch base real quick. How the Christ did you guys find me? I never really explored that. How did you find me? I'm sitting here in Naples talking to Turtle Boy about things, and you find me. I don't get it. How did that happen?
Well, I did work with one other Sean McDonough along the way.
That is true.
That's true.
That is true.
I think Nick found you, didn't he?
Yes, I did. Yep. Sean, I think you were on an earlier chat with the Young Jerks in the beginning.
I was.
It's very important. You had explained and in foreshadowing of where we're at now, how when you were, you know, in the trenches chasing, you know, El Chapo around and all these big things, and you're working a case, you would work a case, you know, let's say it was a bust, I think you mentioned, in California, and you were going to take receipt of some buy, and let's say it was whatever it was, it wasn't anything substantial, and all of a sudden you found yourself down or up this rabbit hole and popped up in a briar patch,
right,
of what was really going on. And one of the biggest busts, I think you said, you know, was trailer truck loads of right. Cannabis. You were saying this, and it was exactly what was happening to us, because I proffered, with the help of a former special prosecutor, police law enforcement attorney, Kevin Salvaggio, in the fall of 2021, to the Rhode Island U.S. Attorney's Office and the Rhode Island Office of the FBI, what had happened to us up to that moment in the company. And basically, you know, what you see is a hostile takeover. I had already had my life threatened. We knew that our phones were tapped. And at that point, we realized that they would do and stop at nothing to take control over the company. We proffered this to the FBI in Rhode Island and the U.S. attorney, and the case was opened up. Right. So at that point, we had determined that we're wiretapping going on our phones. And we determined at that point that the wiretapping was going on by the Boston Police Department. And at that point, a dirty faction in the Chelsea office of the FBI. And we did research and found out they didn't have any warrants to get this. Huh. Well, at that point, Brian Alberts, being ahead of the Fugitive Task Force and running as a liaison to run what we'll talk about as the shadow business of Massachusetts State Police and all the corruption that goes on, the rackets of the Winter Hill Gang, as I will get into detail later on. All of a sudden, unfortunately, John O'Keefe, in looking back at history, had proffered some sorts of drug activity that was going on in Canton. And I'm going to step into maybe D&G Pizza and Pizzagate of Massachusetts. That gets proffered by him, which now the reports say. And then lo and behold, unfortunately, he winds up on the front lawn of Brian Alberts' house. Right. And within a few short hours, they're blaming Karen Reed for this ridiculous murder. We popped up and said, oh my God, these are the same people that were at that point investigating me at the hands of Rachel Rollins, who opened up the original police report with the Boston Police District 1 to try to spin a false narrative that I was Bernie Madoff or Sam, you know, Bankman-Fried of FTX. And I was going to be another fall guy for, you know, the deep state George Soros tech CEO that would tumble and end up in jail and Soros would steal the company. The fight of our lives began.
Right. After what you're saying, basically in the fall of 2021, prior to John's death,
you learned
that your phones were being tapped. Now, I know by my affiliation in my job that we have these boxes. And have you ever heard of the term stingray?
Yes, yes. While this was all happening, I had to because I could get no help and any type of benefit. Dan did not come onto the field of the World Series, you know, until the spring of 2022.
Okay.
I was doing the best I could in trying to capture or catch or build evidence, which I provided to the FBI and the U.S. Attorney of Rhode Island in the fall of all the crimes that were happening and all the unlawful wiretaps. I gave them irrefutable evidence who the people were that were wiretapping the phones, when they did it, how they did it, and were able to show all the people that were in my company, including Dan later on, we had proof that they were actually tapping the phones, geolocating us, chasing us around. It ended up being the world for me, poor Dan himself, and they would geolocate us. And a lot of it was intimidation. And what they started to do, and I just let you guys resort to, you know, the website, God Truth America has a lot of these facts. Just so you know, I've been locked out. You know, there's a hack going on, but there's a lot of informative information. You guys might remember for the last year and a half, there was a lot more Black Hawk helicopter activity that was flying around from, you know, Newport, Rhode Island, where I was in a safe house, to Martha's Vineyard, just down the road from Obama, to Nantucket, to Massachusetts, unfortunately down to Dan's house, and all over Boston during the time that Brian Alberts was still an active officer and in charge of the Fugitive Task Force to bring me home on a false warrant that I assaulted Kevin Peters.
See, that's the part right there. So in other words, you're still, I mean, that whole thing happened. So they were technically hunting you. I mean, you've been on the run, basically, right?
Yes, I have. Yes, I have.
Who taught you the tradecraft? That's what I want to. Who taught you the tradecraft?
I'd be dead already.
You go. That's a good answer. Good answer.
John, if you give me the platform, I will tell you the most wild stories that cannot do anything other than inspire your listeners. The billion to one odds that repeat themselves every few days in the coincidences that will happen to give me an edge to stay ahead of the deep state, to expose everything that's going on in Massachusetts, and then to bring that fight to the people and prevent what I hope doesn't happen in November. People need to get the vote out, talk to their local constituents. Unfortunately, politicians, they're dirty on both sides of the aisle, but George Soros is focused on mass chaos in Massachusetts and wants us to come to arms with each other. How do we stop that? Just tell the truth.
We got to tell the truth.
No, the truth will then inform them, because we're not idiots. You're not going to get away with this, Mr. Soros. We're tired of you running our state, and the truth will set us free. And we just look at Karen Reed and the so back to the tradecraft, Sean.
Okay. Yes.
It is absolutely out of this world. And I say this on my website. I think there's a link there. I did a call who was also in hiding, the former chief editor of Newsmax and the National Enquirer. His name happens to be Gary Greenberg too. And I said, I wanted at some point in the future, either from jail when I write my movie transcripts or at Academy Awards of the many movies, I wanted an honorary FBI degree, a cyber forensics degree, a law degree. And now I want whatever the CIA gives out, because
you have to go to the farm for that, though. You have to go down in Southern Virginia and spend 9 weeks at the farm like I did. And I'll tell you, it's, you ever watch that that movie with the Irish kid there? He's an operative for the CIA going through training. That's the real deal. That's where the tradecraft starts.
Well, I can tell you the hunt. They've spent $25 million creating these scenes where there'll be 100 people in a conference for data, or I'll be in a hotel, right, and all these different people will try to befriend me and tell me what I want to hear, so they could get close to the company and attempt
You know what that's called? It's called a bump. I'm my right hand of God. It's a bump. Someone comes up to you, strokes you, gets to know you, right? It's all about, I'm going to tell you right now, I bet you 10 to 1, they said, can we get to a meeting? Can I get to meet you? And that's called That's a classic bump where they get you to the next meeting. I'm telling you, that's how it goes.
Watch how this segues into the chase. And I use the movie, like, you know, with Leonardo DiCaprio, or Catch Me If You Can.
Right.
This was going on. The only way they could apprehend me, because they have this false, charge against me that I beat up this attorney, which we'll you mentioned a little bit earlier, is they had to have my cell phone number. So that's where the helicopters would canvass. This is in news articles over anywhere I was at, and they would fly low, just like they were, you know, in Iraq trying to find terrorists, you know, with their flip phones. And they had to get my phone number, and then once they had my phone number, they had to scramble. And this is where Proctor, Higgins, Dugal, and Alberts, they went out to the West Coast the same time. I can't remember who went and interviewed Natalie. They weren't out there to interview Natalie. They were out there because they had a thought, a whereabouts, that I was supposed to be at RFK's birthday party. And he was dispatched there because they had
RFK Jr.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. And, just want to make sure you weren't seeing any ghosts now, okay?
No. We'll talk about both.
I know. We'll keep that for another series.
Segues back to how have I been hunted? The only way that they could get me is they had to take me back home on a warrant on the hands of a Boston police officer. This is where the fugitive task force comes in. Brian Alberts was the guy, the bounty hunter, that was hunting me until he resigned. Then it switched over to Proctor, who became the guy in charge.
Right.
And is it, Sean, you would tell me, who went out to see Natalie? Who interviewed Natalie?
It was Tully and an investigator for Mello.
Okay.
A private investigator, and Tully's a lieutenant for the state police.
Yeah, Tully was there in the same 72 hours. I was in Los Angeles and in Manhattan Beach.
I do remember that, because you called me from there, yeah.
Yes, I did. And we'll talk about it later, but I can tell you, they grounded flights at John Wayne International Airport, and they attempted to abduct me at LAX. It's going to be one hell of a movie.
We're coming up on 2,400 people now in 45 minutes of this. Tell me one thing. Why are you public enemy number one? I need to I need to hold on to this. Why are you public enemy number one? Of all the people, why Fiorillo? Why? Why
because,
you?
Because I possess the most powerful weapon in the world, which is the 100% absolute truth of the deep state corruption that has been roiling the state of Massachusetts since probably a few weeks after they signed the U.S. Constitution. And who's been behind it and who's running that is George Soros and Obama and Biden. And they're taking over of the Windmill Hill rackets and managing that through Thomas O'Neill, the local politician, and running, Sean, this is very difficult because you put in a lot of years at DEA, but the government's hand in running the drug trafficking trade throughout the country. And here's what I will say. Why do they do this? The only way you can corrupt anybody, especially more today than ever, because of the powerful internet and the internet connectivity, is with cash. Ladies and gentlemen, the only way to get cash, you can't wire anything and you can't cash checks. Just ask, you know, big Joe Biden, the big guy, and Hunter Biden. They need cash. Where do they get it? Right out of the docks of New Bedford, Massachusetts, the sex trafficking. And unfortunately, all the Windmill Hill rackets, Tommy O'Neill was partners with a lot of these cops in the old haunts from Cape Cod to, you know, Tremont Street and all the way up to Maine. They took over the restaurants and bars that were owned by the mafia that now Tommy O'Neill, even George Soros, George Soros's brother, the Howard police, Lieutenant Mon. I mean, they all own these bars and restaurants. Well, they're not in there selling French fries and hamburgers. These are all the old bookie places and where they did all their, you know, their trafficking. And this is the evidence I possess, putting George Soros's left hands, the CEO of NPR News, the CEO of Wikimedia, was in the house that I, you know, that Dan and I talked about earlier. And they put him in there as a plant to pose as a innocent vacationer so they could bust into the property and then police state the contents which contained the company's trade secrets.
Right.
As they were in there, they put the sheriffs out front and they went under the guise of a foreclosure for non-payment of, you know, a mortgage payment that I wasn't required to make on over $100 million loan. So
they basically doctored up some paperwork to get access to your residence. Is that basically what you're saying?
Well, no, it's not doctored up paperwork. They ran one of the biggest shakedown corruption loan sharking schemes in the history of the country because they're loan sharking to get control of $100 billion project. And how are they able to do this? You ask yourself every time Karen Reed would go to court and Alan Jackson and David Yannetti would stand up there and scratch their heads of why they weren't getting justice, why they weren't getting relief in the courts. It's because that judge is bought and paid for by the deep state, taking her orders from Thomas O'Neill. Judge Krupp ends up in the narrative with Karen Reed in front of Turtle Boy. Judge Krupp is the former attorney of Whitey Bulger, who's supposed to sit in Suffolk Superior Court. Judge Casper is the wife of the CEO of Thermo Fisher at the law firm that I was attacked by Kevin Peters. This is out of control, ladies and gentlemen.
So, Nikki, I'm going to tell you, we had a little offline conversation, and the person that we talked about is in the chat, and the people you just mentioned, she is all over there. She has zoned in on these people, and I, you know, she knows who she is. I'm not going to mention her, but I got to tell you right now, there is something coming down the pike. We talked about this. When her information and your information through these series that we're going to be doing, right, gels with the now, what we know now is happening. This is great with the Karen Reed case, okay? We now know, finally, the FBI was able to do something incredible for that case, to give up how they got the information, how they realized who was talking to who. We always knew it. The problem was in the state courts, they were handcuffed. They were absolutely handcuffed because, as you know, right? Let me ask you a question. Even in your own perils, right? You'd had to believe that Brian Albert had to have had dirt on someone to push the button to cover this up. Give me your thoughts about that. Just quickly, since we are, what do you think really happened? to cause. So
I'm quite sure of what happened and what role he plays. So Brian Albert, not unlike other high level ranking police officials, it's quite simple. Those in law enforcement in Massachusetts that get promoted and promoted quickly are corrupted. Those who don't, that put in the time and work for, 20, 30 years and, leave their police officer or maybe up a rank or two, are not corrupted.
No, how they're the 6%ers. They're 6% of the force that do the work. The other 94%, they're on the dole. They're just collecting a check or they're corrupted.
I'm going to explain what happens. So as we know, our state has been roiled with overtime scandals for decades.
Oh, Jesus.
The guys that were working true, that were doing the best they could, their way to get paid off or hush money to allow this criminal activity to continue within our law enforcement were the guys that would unfortunately get their hush money from putting in overtime they never worked for. It's important, Sean, to let the residents of Massachusetts know we've been in these positions before. We've been in these battles, but never before in the history of our country has the truth aligned with the relevance and the victims have gotten a voice, and you're part of that voice. So we're in a unique time in history. If we continue on this path to expose the deep state corruption and start putting pressure on our media, the media will be forced to tell both sides of the story. And I went back earlier. What else does the Massachusetts residents need to see when they put Karen Reed and the memes on the front page of the papers when she looks like a villain or an evil witch?
Right.
What else do you need to understand that is George Soros and unfortunately Dan's former employer, John Henry, spinning out the narrative?
Wait, hold on a second. I was only there for 12 hours with John Henry. Okay. Okay.
That's right. So what else do you need to see? They are putting her in a negative light, and she's guilty by a photo on the front page above the fold of some of the most used to be respected media publications in the country. Right. That isn't fair to her. That's not truth. That's not justice. No. John Henry exposed himself when he allowed those photos to be put on the Globe. The Boston Herald exposed themselves. Ted Daniels exposed himself for who really runs the country and those who cover the media. When they put that innocent girl's photos on there, making her look like a villain, we're not stupid.
Right. So Dan, can you comment from your perspective on the Reed case? I know you were talking about the civil rights and everything. Can you give us a little comment on this since we've rushed into this area now?
Yeah, I want to talk a little bit about the repossession of Nick's family home.
Oh, yeah.
In Harwich, okay? Because I witnessed this. It's the same playbook. It's another attempt to frame Nick for a crime he didn't commit. It was a unlawful foreclosure of his family home, which he had homesteaded in Harwichport. They unlawfully evicted him and his family, his wife Tracy and their two kids. And the eviction was coordinated by Detective Brackett of the Harwich Police Department. He worked closely with the Barnstable County Sheriff's Association. They got support from a magistrate judge, and they proceeded to abscond with the family's possessions, including their cars. But there was another operative in the house that had rented the house out, and they tried to say that that Nick didn't have the right to rent the house out and that he took the money of this operative who was in the house to steal the intellectual property of the company. And then Detective Brackett filed another warrant under false pretenses to arrest Nick, this time for a crime that he didn't commit. Not only was it a crime that he didn't commit, there was no crime. There was no crime. And that warrant is active as well. They tried to get a second warrant on Nick to limit his ability to show up in court or to risk his life to come back and have him go to jail, have him spend time. So, I mean, this is a pretty widespread operation, right? It was a Boston Police Department. the Harwich Police Department. And then, you know, when you think about some of the other things that we've seen in the Massachusetts court, just before Christmas, we were in a court in central Massachusetts, and there was a judgment, a farcical court judgment of $550 million against $550 million judgment against Mr. Fiorillo in favor of Northern Bank CEO James Mon, who's the brother of the Massachusetts State Police Colonel John Mon.
Wait a minute. Hold on.
And John Mon resides a baseball throw from Nick in Harwichport from the house that was repossessed unlawfully. $550 million judgment in favor of Colonel Mon's brother's bank.
So
against Nick Fiorillo. So, you know, you have to wonder how far this corruption extends throughout the state when you see things like this happening. And if I didn't see it myself, I wouldn't believe it, Sean.
Well, that's what I'm saying, Dan. I mean, I've been sometimes called the voice of reason. You are the voice of reason, Dan, because, I mean, let's say Nick is an encyclopedia. But when I hear you and the way you break it down, but this is crazy because you're talking about the brother of the colonel of the state police who just yesterday announces after over almost 2 years that they finally put this kid under IA investigation, when I know for myself, I've been hitting this guy Proctor for over almost a year now, almost a year. And it's taken this guy this long to wake up. This all makes up, but you're talking almost a half a billion dollars, more than a half a billion dollars.
$550 million.
$200 million more than President Trump.
It wasn't a mistake because it was delivered to upset the financing of the data corridor in Connecticut.
Amazing. I'm just blown. I was always blown away. I think between the Karen Reed case and Nick, your constant vigilance on getting me, but it's now all coming together. It truly is coming all together. It's all about corruption.
John, it's a miracle. It's a miracle to save this country. If people believe in God and country, we go back to the founding of the country. Let's say we landed on Plymouth Rock. They were part of the making and the four corners of the U.S. Constitution. Where else would the battle happen than right back where it started in Boston, Massachusetts? It is the true Gotham City of our country. And I want all residents in Massachusetts, we the people, the citizens, think of all the innocent people and hatred and fighting going on in Canton, Mass, at the town hall, and all the unrest everywhere. The scariest part of all this is people need to realize there is a couple different powers that are in going on, okay? And I'm going to try to do my best to set it up to educate the people, because after this segment, I know just what to do and how to fix it and what we can do to not only save our towns, save our city, Boston, and save Massachusetts. It's a test case that could then repeat itself in other states, unfortunately, that have been roiled by, is it political? Well, what do you do with dirty Irishmen from South Boston when Whitey Bulger isn't around anymore? The political mafia is what's going on. And they just took over. Bulger, his brother, was in charge. But when you really put a handle on it, if something doesn't make sense out there, ladies and gentlemen, it's the deep state that's behind it. When Turtle Boy gets locked up, it doesn't make sense. A judge makes a ruling. It's the deep state that's behind it. Turtle Boy is at the mercy of what the deep state wants to do and where they point him to put the spotlight on it. He's been doing it since... when I was, out in Worcester, at St. John's, you mentioned, from Shrewsbury. He was put into the Massachusetts State Police to give a couple fall guys with the new movie. You know, Ryan Gosling came out the other day. He's the fall guy that would go in and said, oh, well, the deep state needs some villains to go away for this crazy drug trafficking scandal in Massachusetts.
Right.
So Turtle Boy got the tip. He put the spotlight on him. His crazy self went out there and started blasting these people. And the corrupt deep state cops and judges made sure a couple people went away to do what? Keep the secret quiet. so it could continue on. The same thing that happened with the Whitey Bulger trial. Whitey Bulger, you know, on the run. We get a couple theatrical, you know, kabuki theater greatest hits. Whitey Bulger turns up alive in May 2023. You don't believe it? Go look at the photos on God Truth America. The overtime scandal, well, that needed to happen. The scariest part is George Soros wants anarchy in Massachusetts.
And, you know, Nick,
he's getting it is what bringing us to fight with each other over the truth. We know the truth.
When you bring up the deep state, and now listen, I mean, the deep state sometimes is a curse word. Sometimes it's the savior for a lot of people. It's just basic. This is what it truly is. It's the state of who has the power. You know, it could be easy as someone saying, they're the ones that got the guns. They're the ones that got the technology. They're the ones who are in charge, right?
Yeah.
And that's what this is all about. But I do want to get back to one thing. Now, you are on a radio / TV type scenario with Wayne Allen Root?
Allen Root, one of Donald Trump's best friends.
That's what I want to know. What is your connection to Donald Trump?
So it's a copycat. It's what Dan said earlier. It's the playbook of the deep state. We look at Karen Reed. We look at Turtle Boy. You could actually predict what the next moves are by them by just following suit of what happened to me and what happened to us. They play something, and I think Dan is an expert on this. Sam Adams uses the word lawfare. You know, in 1700s or 1800s, and they used the Constitution that was framed by, you know, our founding fathers, and they play within that four corner document, but they control the ballpark, the concession, the ticket sales, the ball players, and who's calling the shots. And those are the judges, those are the umpires. So they continue to manipulate everything from what Ted Daniels doesn't talk about on television to what the Globe doesn't write about, and they suppress the truth, and it puts us in odds at each other's throats. So when you say the deep state, it is corruption from Main Street to Washington to 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, and it's ran and has been run out of Massachusetts for, you know, 50, 60 years.
I'll be the first one to admit I was so embarrassed to have spent almost 29 years of my life working under the Department of Justice when I knew, listen, I can tell you right now, to get a Pfizer application, just to get a Pfizer, it takes an arm and a leg. These guys were getting Pfizer application warrants like they were giving out little chiclets on the street to poor people, to the little gum. And I said to myself, there is something definitely wrong. Now, obviously, this is not to take a shot at the FBI agents who are on the ground, who are doing the job, who are doing a great, great justice for Karen Reed. All right.
Yep.
They figured this out. But you're right. It's political. And I feel bad. I feel bad for Donald because he came in like a wildfire. He wasn't a politician. And they listen, both sides targeted him. Let's not put it on the Democrats. Oh. We had rhinos. Both yep. sides targeted him.
So I got a little off track. So about, Donald Trump, like me,
yes, right.
We're real estate developers.
Okay.
Right. And again, this is for history. And I wasn't political by any means, but it's the only place I could find comfort and help was at Mar-a-Lago. So I was there last week for two nights, with Wayne Allen Root and getting to interact with the president and being held up. The FBI, the CIA knows I've been held up at the Trump Tower in Las Vegas, and I'm waiting for them to raid the place. Come on and get me. and being there, seeing this poor real estate developer that fell into a run for president in 2016. And what it was is similar to me and similar to Karen, similar to Turtle Boy. Well, these people, these truth seekers, by mistake, they might drop the curtain of what really happens and how the country really runs. Well, they didn't see Donald Trump coming, and they didn't see us coming tonight, Sean. No. You're not deplatformed. This is going to break the internet when this gets out. It's the same thing that happened to me. He had a $350 million judgment in New York in the Southern District. He had the same type of antics go on in the courtroom where he was fined if he stood up and spoke his piece. Sure. He was prevented from presenting evidence. He was prevented from evidentiary hearings. He was prevented from calling witnesses.
Sure.
They did all that to, they played lawfare to put him in a point where they could penalize him $350 million if he didn't shut his mouth. The same thing happened to me. Dan witnessed.
That's the same thing they've done in the Massachusetts courts.
It's ridiculous.
What they've done with Trump. No evidentiary hearings, a rush to judgment. You can't appear in court. You can't get into the hearing. We're not going to file your documents. All these things, all these dishonest things within the judicial system. I've witnessed for the past year and a half in Massachusetts, and we spoke to a number of people to try to write them just to get fair process for Nick, his family, process from the company, just to be able to give our point of view in a legal form, just to get some equity from the judge, just to get some evidence into the record. They won't allow the evidence. We can't get an evidentiary hearing. Okay, you know, it's just ridiculous. All across, I've probably been in over 20 hearings. We've had one that was equitable. The rest they stacked the deck.
Yeah, Dan, I think we should tell that story. And I know you might have to go, but Sean, what I'm hopeful, and we don't get deplatformed by the deep state.
Well, you know,
we can tell these stories, and when people hear these stories, if you think that what happened to Karen Reed is an atrocity, I'm the vessel. It could happen to any of us. It's happening to a former president, and hopefully soon to be the new president again.
Right.
And his job is only to educate the populace, put us back on track, and get rid of what he says the swamp, and get out, you know, out the corruption. Yeah. When you hear some of the antics, I'm going to just take you back. I think it's wild. And I want to inform everybody, because what you're doing is you're educating yourself so you can spread the word and bring attention to Massachusetts. Let's make this the battleground to rebuild the country as it was built before. And all we need to do, people, is head on to the social media network. Please go see my friend Elon Musk on X, because it's the only place you might not get deplatformed. And repost, you know, this episode, repost the pictures of Whitey Bulger, because we will upend the country's corruption and rout it out right here under Josh Levy's command in Massachusetts, and rebuild the country. But I want to take you to this. So the day that Dan is referencing is very cute. It involves the house that Dan came to save me from. We were in the Southeastern Housing Court in front of what is now coined the most conservative judge in America, Judge Michaud, in the Southeast Housing Court. I had a hearing where the deep state, Raymond Green, Thomas O'Neill, George McLaughlin, Soros were trying to foreclose on my house. So the night before the hearing, the night before many hearings, they would call up and we'd be on the phones with Dan, and they would say, okay, kid, if you want to have some place to sleep tomorrow night, you're going to sign here, release us, bury the secret, and give us 97% of the stock in your company, or you're going to have no place to sleep tomorrow. This is on recorded lines that I submitted and proffered to the FBI.
They wanted 97% of your company?
Stock. I had to step down as CEO. This happened 100 times. They threatened to shoot me with a .45 caliber. They threatened to jail me. They attempted to kill me 3 times. It's unbelievable. I have all the evidence, all the irrefutable proof, and I'll be posting it on the website, God Truth America, as soon as I can unlock it.
And law enforcement is definitely involved.
Oh my! They're the hitmen. It's the hit squad. Brian Albert was in charge of the deep state hit squad in Massachusetts from she to signing she. He would go around and silence whatever drug dealers. I'm getting off point, but let me get back to this Judge Michaud. It's a hoop.
Right.
It's so one of many hearings. You know, Dan and I are. I can't go to the courthouse. They have the courthouse surrounded with SWAT, with undercover police, with different sheriffs. If I put my physical presence to defend my homestead in a courtroom anywhere in Massachusetts and show up to save my company, to save my home, to defend myself from an unlawful warrant that they had no crime exist, I would be arrested before walking in. We have all the police comms. We have all the evidence. Each time there was a court hearing in Massachusetts, that Brian Alberts, then to Tully, Higgins, and Proctor, would surround the courthouse. We have on this one hearing, Michael Powers from Boston PD District 1 or Precinct 1, working with Carl Dugal on the police comms, trying to rush to a court hearing in southeastern Massachusetts, getting stuck in traffic and not getting there before I was going to show up. Dan and I appear on Zoom out of nowhere, and we get into it with Judge Michaud. And I'm able to put into the record, and our enemy admits, George Soros' front guy, a loan shark, Raymond Green, Harold Brown's partner, the Innofin front guy that they robbed $150 million from other residents in Massachusetts in the InfoSyn scandal that George Soros manipulated. Ray Green admits on the record, and this is on the website, Nick Fiorillo wasn't supposed to make any payments on his houses in Nantucket, Harwichport, or Dedham, Massachusetts. I would allow the loans to annul and accumulate interest because it was in our agreements, and right. He would pay me off on a refinance or a sale of these properties. He wasn't supposed to make any payments. So then the judge says, well, Mr. Green, you're trying to foreclose on Mr. Fiorillo's house, and you filed paperwork in the court of law that says you're foreclosing because he failed to make payments. Case dismissed, and he dismissed wow. the case right in front of George Soros's eyes and Ray wow. Green's eyes. The next day, they launched an international press release that they cooked up this story. This is the deep state. People Google it. Judge Michaud, the most conservative judge in the United States of America, was then sanctioned and charged by the Massachusetts Judicial Oversight Committee for a 2018 or 2020 Facebook post to his close friends that he felt that we should look into the election and recounting the votes. They turned around and filed charges to strip him of his robe within 72 hours after he gave the one fair ruling I've ever gotten in the Massachusetts court. Wow. They attacked him, and then they put out a press release to 400 international media outlets. Judge Michaud is sanctioned in the Massachusetts court for standing up to challenge, you know, the vote of the President Trump, and they tried to strip his robe away. Well, what do you think happened to him? Well, the next time we went in front of him, this would be 6 or 8 months later, we went right up front of him, and you'll hear all the tapes in our FOIA requests that no one seems to answer, and all the people need to go and get these transcripts. You're going to hear the judge, in his own words, throw my case out without an evidentiary hearing. He silenced me. He wouldn't let me speak, and he dismissed my case, or so he thought. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm on the edge of the U.S. Supreme Court. Because I could never walk into a courthouse in Massachusetts to do what? Defend my civil rights, to defend myself. Because Brian Alberts and his hit squad, Carl Dugal, Michael Powers, Bobby Brackett, Higgins, Proctor, and Colonel Mon of the Massachusetts State Police, who is my neighbor in Harwichport, Massachusetts. I could take a stone and crash one of his corrupt windows. Yeah. I live across the street. This is a big news break. From George McLaughlin, who's the uncle of McLaughlin that's in the Karen Reed case, who's assisting Lally in the prosecution of Karen Reed. Wow. And I live down the street in Nantucket from George Soros's brother. I found myself in the nexus of the most corrupt, you know, place in the world, you know, Cape Cod.
Right.
I can't tell you that the Supreme Court is going to hear, going back to where Sam Adams was. How could I ever, how could Karen, how could, unfortunately, George Soros' operative Turtle Boy ever have the opportunity in a court of law to defend themselves if they control the judges, they control the guns and the cops, and they control the way the system works? It's called the secret courts, ladies and gentlemen.
I actually posted a video today from the Boston Spotlight team on the secret court processes in the city of Boston. And I thought it was fascinating that I was going to have you guys come on tonight. And I have to go back real quick. It's what we're forgetting to, and this is my platform. It's always been, we have a dead Boston police officer. They just trounced all over him, right?
Yes.
They really did. And I know you were in a tough spot, Nikki and Dan.
I'm going to be okay, Sean. Aaron, you don't worry about it.
No, I understand that. But don't you go through this $500 million to put pressure on you, to take your company, you know?
Sean, they kidnapped my daughter, but it was the wrong girl. I could go on. The stories I'm going to tell your listeners,
right,
the citizens of Massachusetts, is going to end up putting George Soros in jail, because there's no one on earth that can explain why George Soros put CEOs of some of the biggest companies that he has funded, Lisa Monaco, you're going to hear about this, the Deputy Inspector General of the United States in three Democratic administrations under Obama, Biden, and the Clintons, was in my house Thanksgiving weekend this year with my twin, a CIA operative, Marty Monaco, and they attempt to murder me, and police state that house too. George Soros cannot explain why he's putting his closest chess pieces into my properties in Massachusetts, Harwichport, Nantucket, and the mansion that Roger Marino gave me in Dedham, Massachusetts, the founder of EMC. We find the CEO of Moderna that's been in my house, the CEO of Reddit that's been in my house, and that's just down the street from the Dedham courthouse where all this is going on in the Massachusetts. Please, people, go to the website, Got Truth America, educate yourself, and then put the word out to your local politicians and say enough is enough, and vote the dirty politicians out of office, ask for a review of the Massachusetts State Police, support Josh Levy and what he's doing, and know that the FBI has good people in it. There are good agents in there.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully with the good work that Levy's doing and with the FBI helping out, we'll see these cases dismissed. We'll see Karen Reed and justice for John O'Keefe. We'll see that case dismissed. We'll see these tainted cases against Scott Space. And hopefully we'll see a safer, more honest system in Massachusetts for the whole state.
Well, I mean, so let me ask you a question. Do you guys want to make a series out of this? Do you want to do like a weekly weekly thing? Because I can tell you, Nikki, I got to tell you.
You can talk to Nikki. I got to get going, guys. Thanks for having me on.
But listen, Dan,
I enjoyed it. We'll continue our dialogue.
Right. Dan, I totally respect you coming on the show. Totally respect all the conversations we've had over the course of since July. It's truly been an honor. And I got to tell you, I was blown away when Nikki says, I've got Dan Duquette here. I said, wait a minute, hold on. I thought you guys were spoofing me. I said, this is crazy.
Fans, man. We all grew up loving the Red Sox.
But I thought you guys were spoofing me. I said, no, this has got to be a prank. These guys are.
We've seen a lot, and we can testify to it. Hopefully, things turned around. And you keep up the good work, man. You're doing some great work for the citizens.
For full disclosure, this is the first time I've ever laid eyes on you. It's always been down the rabbit hole.
We've always talked.
It's great. By the way, can I ask you guys a question? Is there any way you guys can give me a super chat? I mean, I just want to make sure that you guys know I don't have any things to click super chats, coffees. I mean, I'm doing this for nada because I don't want it. I want justice. I want the Nikki Fiorillos of the world, the Karen Reza, the John O'Keefe. This is what I want. I don't want anything, but I just want to make sure that other people in particular know that.
As we say goodnight to Dan Duquette, we really appreciate him and coming out and basically laying down the true, you know, I call him the most honest man in baseball, which he's going to go down in history for that.
Standing
behind the truth and realizing what is actually happening in Massachusetts in front of our very eyes. The website Got Truth America. Now, again, I've been locked out of it. Soros has got his people in there, but you can still get to it. a lot of these things are in there with the evidence. You can read the lawsuits, you can read and see the photos and the evidence and hear the recordings. The most important thing, if something should happen to me, and it is, they've attempted multiple assassinations on my life, is that I submitted everything I'm telling you, every stitch of evidence, to the Boston office of the FBI, to the office in Waikiki Beach, Honolulu, to the FBI office in Dan's home state. And the feds have everything from the fall of 2021 forward, but we got no relief and no one has come to us, but we have irrefutable proof. And we want people to do what? Take on and fight back in a civil lawfare media war. This is a civil lawfare media war that is being silenced. They're silencing our free speech. They're silencing the truth in Massachusetts. And just take the website and spread it around. People aren't stupid. And know that Karen Reed was framed by the same people that framed me and the same exact people that went after President Donald Trump in a textbook, like he has an encyclopedia set in Bedford, New York, at George Soros's house, how to take over the world and have evil win with friends like John Henry that, you know, Soros right. controls and owns. Who else do you need with the Boston Globe?
Right.
We need to get the truth out, and we need to make sure in November we can turn Massachusetts red, because the dirty politicians here in Massachusetts that are all blue, that have been roiling our state, need to go. Massachusetts turns red. I want to explain something. I was at Mar-a-Lago with Donald Trump himself. And when the vote came in and we saw the count between Nikki Haley and Donald Trump, it was a dead even heat in Massachusetts. I think it was 112,000 votes for the Republicans and 112,000 votes for President Biden. That is a dead heat in Massachusetts. If we can get the vote out in November, we will educate the country and inform them that we're not going to stand for corruption. I'm sorry to make this political, but it's our only hope left is what? In our democracy? And what is our democracy based on? The pillars of truth within the court system and having it free from corruption. Everybody's knocking their heads in the wall. Every night we go to bed, we listen to Turtle Boy, we listen to Clara, we listen to LTL, and no one wants to talk about who DA Hamburg Morrissey works for, who Brian Alberts takes orders from, who Higgins is actually following instructions from. They're going to try to brush this under the rug, and that's why Turtle Boy's on the front lines. He's taking the low-level fruit. It's rotten, and he's going to brush it under the Soros rug. Hey, Turtle Boy, start telling the whole truth, but we start telling the truth about you.
If here we
you
go.
Take your people, and you can really educate the populace, I have the proof that George Soros has funded you. Come over to the good side and reset America right here in Massachusetts before they lock you up again.
I said this would be controversial.
It is.
And I delivered. And like I said, guys.
I got all the receipts about my friend Turtle Boy. And okay. I'm going to say it because I might
Sean,
get killed.
Sean, I'm going to go.
Good, okay. Good night. I'll see you guys. Thank you so much,
thanks
my friend.
Good to be with you guys.
Take okay. care. We'll have you back on, Dan. I can right. guarantee you that's great.
Love you, Dan. Right, thank bye-bye. You, Dan.
All right. All right. What so here we go. Sean. We got about maybe another 5 minutes left. I just want to wrap it up with you. Are you really? Committed? Are you committed to doing a weekly series on this?
Sean, I've seen you ramble on for 3 hours. Listen, you have people that need to
you
be
understand. Informed. I've been on the show of every these people attest Sunday night, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
This okay. may be the last time you ever see me.
No, come on, stop this.
One. The Boeing guy got killed, the Kamal murders in Dover, Massachusetts.
No, I know.
You think that it happened by accident? This needs to be told.
I know. But what I want to do is I want to give, this was like a little test because, as you know, before when we were talking back in the summer, it was all about Karen Reed, justice for John, justice for Karen. And I still want to do this, right?
Yeah.
But I'm bringing corruption to the forefront. This is not only about Massachusetts. This is going to be about the whole country, all right? I want to begin a platform that allows people like you. Listen, if you didn't have the resources like Karen Reed, like, for instance, if it was me, I'd be in jail right now. I don't have the resources. You know that? And this is how these people operate. fortunately for you, fortunately for Karen, fortunately for other people, they could stand up. They thought she would buckle. They thought you would buckle. Look at you. You got $560 million judgment. How the hell are you going to pay that back?
That's nothing, please. The project's $100 billion.
Yeah, I know, really.
We all know who's trying to take it away.
Right. What I wanted to do to these fans out here, these great people.
How many people are tuning in right now?
We're touching upon 3,900 right now.
My friends, these are guys and my friends, if they start telling the truth about what's really going on in Massachusetts, I'll leave Turtle Boy alone.
The poor kid has enough problems.
My friend, Turtle Boy just needs to tell the rest of the story.
Well,
and be okay.
Okay.
All he's going to tell the rest of the story. Who do these people work for? Because once he exposes them, he'll be able to take back control for the people, and we can start really doing some good work in cleaning up Massachusetts. Because this is about people like Karen Reed and avenging John O'Keefe's death. Because he basically went and started telling just a little bit of the truth that I want to tell you.
Yeah. And about this is what I want. We don't want to front load this because, Nikki, listen, you are a walking encyclopedia. I'm impressed. You are a little bit of a, you're a hot wire, man. You are.
I'm just telling the truth. I'm sorry if people don't.
I know. I love it. You have no notes. You could talk. Someone said you could talk till tomorrow night, till midnight. I know you could.
My life's on the line, Sean. I have no choice.
That is true. You bring up a good point. Your life is on. I know you've been running. I mean, by the way, before we get off, how's your wife doing? How's that whole thing going?
So despite what the deep state thinks, everybody knows, you know, we're fighting justice and crime and we're doing great considering the circumstances. This is just the beginning. I mean, Colonel Mon of the Massachusetts State Police is my neighbor with the $550 million judgment from his brother that controls the mafia bank of all time. Get ready, Northern Bank. The FDIC is coming, just like Josh Levy. They're not going to tolerate what you guys do. And I would also really like people to understand that I'm not against, you know, the bloggers out there. I know how risky it is. Turtle Boy sat in jail for 90 days. He's basically being tossed around like a, you know, a stuffed animal that is using the media and what he sees fit to spin narratives. I just take you back to his own words, Sean. I want to say this. His own words early on tried to say that I was insane. And he went online. I want to
listen. Please. We're going to keep this a little drama free.
Yeah, I'm not mad at him. I was insane. Most recently, this is important. When he wanted justice to come to Canton, Massachusetts, he was going to go on Mike Crawford's show and he said, I'll tell you what, Hamburg Morrissey, I'm coming with a Soros-backed district attorney to run against you in Norfolk County. Hey, Turtle Boy, watch what you say online. When you back Soros-funded DAs like Rachel Mullins, the truth's going to get you too. Just come over to the good side and start telling us.
Listen, all right, Nick. Listen, this is the first series. You know, like I said, there's certain things I can verify. There's certain things I can't. You're the owner of your story, and I know. Listen, I've got you have a volumes of motions. I mean, you really are.
Please check out the website and pass it around. Make sure Turtle Boy takes a look at it.
I'm sure. Listen, Colonel.
This is about Karen Reed.
Aiden was definitely entrenched in the Karen Reed story. I think he's going to open up now. Listen, here's the thing, Nikki. Right? We're not going to conquer the world in one night. We're almost at an hour and a half now. Listen, I'm so glad
Shortest episode yet. Don't worry.
But Nikki, listen, we're going to have many.
Tomorrow.
I'm going to tell you right now. This guy. He calls me, right? We go back and forth. I can't stop him. I cannot stop this guy. I got to say, Nikki, for Christ's sake, please, where's Dan? I have to talk to Dan. But no, the thing is, no. Listen, Nikki, you look like a kid. How old are you? Seriously, how old are you?
Sean, I'm 49, but believe it or not, I am not stressed out.
I can't believe it.
Such a place of peace because I already see the future. I know that Massachusetts is going to crumble as far as the corruption. Right. I know that Josh Levy, with the support of the federal government that is the incoming administration is sick and tired of the corruption. I mean, I could go on. The hospitals in Rhode Island and Massachusetts, those have been embezzled. George Soros embezzled $3.5 billion. His hedge funds control those hospitals. So don't get upset with me telling the truth.
No, I'm the backer of the truth. Trust me, I'm the backer of the truth. But I want to keep us alive. Okay. Yeah. I want to keep the truth going. Okay. Yeah. And we've got 4,059 patriots out there who are listening to us, and the number keeps growing.
Sean, if you promoted this, I told you you would break the internet. You promoted this in 1 hour. I'm going to give you the record of all time. You put this thing up at 5 o'clock and you have 4,000 plus live feeds.
Hour and a half.
Take that to the bank.
Buddy, I've been taken to the bank since Sunday.
Watch this. If you want to prove a point of how powerful this is, set us up for next Thursday, same time and place, right now.
Absolutely. Okay.
And then watch. Here's the goal.
Okay.
I bet you you'll have 25,000 waiting in your waiting room because Wayne Root, National News, will go on to every major news outlet in the country and preempt for to tune in next Thursday at 7 o'clock for the.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about that. Are you going back on Wayne's show again?
Yes. So I would like to invite you on Wayne Root's show.
I would love to.
You're part of this is part two.
No, I'm not a PR guy, right? We know that. Am I a PR guy?
You're a guy that knows. No, you're doing unbelievable.
No, I'm not a PR guy.
What we have is we came up with this series that you now are part of. It's called War Behind Enemy Lines. And what we're doing is an investigative series. And we're going into stories that are starting with our truths because we're on the battle lines. We're at the front row of civil media lawfare in Massachusetts with John Henry publishing photos in the Boston Globe and Ted Daniels putting the most ridiculous pictures of Karen Reed, making her look guilty or like a villain or somebody like the devil. What else does the public need to see that George Soros is controlling the media? He owns the Boston Globe.
No, he owns
the Boston Red Sox.
I would have to tell you,
is the front for George Soros.
In the words of my recently deceased father, all right, I have to tell you this. He always said that John Henry, he's no good. He's ruined the Red Sox. He's ruined this. He's got all the money in the world. He won't pay for this.
All he is a puppet for George Soros.
Right.
The building they're in was the building that Soros built, and he built it under the most corrupted construction project with Bulger in the Senate, who got the $800,000 bribe so they could put the building up. That's where the Boston Globe is. That's where John Henry's headquarters are. John Henry, the same message that I sent to Turtle Boy, start telling the truth, or we're going to start telling the whole truth about you. Start printing the truth in Massachusetts, or the truth will bury you.
I want to rewind to that judge that.
Yes.
That judge.
I'm serious. If I die tonight, it'd be the Chinese. I'm telling you.
Okay.
This is serious, serious.
Rewinding back to that judge that was favored for you. In the words of Tucker Carlson, what that judge did afterwards, he obeyed.
Yes, he did.
In the words of Tucker Carlson, he obeyed. He bowed down. And said, yes, 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 he obeyed. And that's the problem. We don't have, like I said yesterday on my show, where are the men of Canton? Where are the men of democracy? The real men, not the people who obey, like the judge. That judge was in favor. You there, Nikki? You're there,
No, I'm reading the comments of the Soros faction. You can clearly see who they are. They're like, Nikki, you better shut your mouth and you don't know what you're doing. No.
But the thing is, we know how this goes. We know how this goes. We know how dangerous this is. You know, I hate to say the game, but we do know how dangerous it is. And I know, listen, people, I've talked to this guy. He had an attempt on him in Fort Lauderdale. Was it Miami?
One of three. And again, it was an intimidation factor.
Sure.
This was a... a controlled Soros intimidation factor where they smashed an exotic rental car in the in the valet area of the Fountain Blue Hotel and attempted to push me down across the highway and into the Miami River with a full-blown investigation by the Miami PD to only be a set of coincidences that they're attempting. But when you find out who the driver was of the car, he was an employee of one of Soros's shell corporations from the Open Society Foundation Network. There has been the raid on the Satay Hotel in Miami with a banker that worked with Devin Archer and Hunter Biden. I didn't know any better. And I think it was recently that I was sitting down for dinner to talk with an investor.
Now, listen, as you know, this is more of a Karen Reed based audience.
Go right back to it. Yeah.
They're loving this right here.
Yeah.
Please talk about, do you see what Leah Baker's talking about? Do you see that comment on the screen?
Yeah, I'll do a recap.
Please do it. Take it. Now, I'm going to give you all the time in the world, but stay on point. Stay on point.
Okay. So, and we're starting again for those tuning in now. So I'm Nick Fiorillo. I'm the founder of Got Space Data, and the company is developing the New England Data Quarter, which is a $100 billion digital infrastructure project in the state of Connecticut that will control the next 100 years of America and its ability to transact financials, to med ed and tech and innovate, and the DOD and defense in Groton, Connecticut. And though that data center quarter was actually the failed project of Hunter Biden, the Obama administration, the Bulgers, this is all not new news. The Bulger family is partners with the Biden family in taking money in the Thornton group, which founded in Boston and funded in Boston, in a data center at Mohegan Hill. And their failure in that project and in fumbling the money, hence the Hunter Biden laptop and the Chinese partnership. This is all facts. And then the company being founded in late 2020 and my attempts to bring funding to it, I've been victimized by the weaponization of the Massachusetts judicial, political, and law enforcement system, and the manipulation of the courts, the cops, and the judges, and attempting to frame me, just like Donald Trump, for crimes I did not commit, and using lawfare to get judgments against me to prevent the companies from funding moving forward. I received a $550 million judgment that came down from Lieutenant Mon's, Colonel Mon of the Massachusetts State Police's brother, who owns the Northern Bank and Trust Company, which is the mob bank of Massachusetts. And that correlating into the exact same lawfare when I exposed in 2021, I proffered that story I just told you to the Rhode Island office of the FBI and the U.S. Attorney of Rhode Island. They opened up an investigation into what was happening, and they began a counter surveillance of Brian Alberts, of the Boston Police Department, and of Rachel Rollins as they were attempting to take control of my company. Lo and behold, in the late January, unfortunately, John O'Keefe ends up on the front lawn of Brian Alberts' house, murdered, I will say. And we have sources that confirm that the feds watched it all happen. At the time that this took place, John O'Keefe had proffered information similar to what I was proffering about the corruption within Canton and the drug trade. And I this is like Pizzagate all over again. Right. And when he told that to the Canton police, of course, the FBI, Joseph Bonavallotta, the former director of the Boston office of the FBI, was best friends with the former chief of the Canton police. John O'Keefe wound up dead. And then Karen Reed was the fall guy.
Tell us about your dealings with Carl Dougal.
Yes. So leading up to after John O'Keefe's murder and the frame of Karen Reed, it started a full-on lawfare of every time that Karen would go to court, the same characters would show up. Carl Dougal, Mike Powers, Higgins would be in the peanut gallery of every hearing she was going to. Well, every time I would show up, Dan Duquette was there on Zoom and different things. I would show up in front of Judge Krupp in Suffolk Superior Court, and I'd have the same Boston police officers, CIA, FBI, and undercovers in the gallery and attempting to intimidate, and they were investigating me by trying to pin me as a CEO that embezzled money. I was a fraudster. I wasn't who I said I was. And that boiled over until a full-on Operation Schoolhouse. This is similar to what they would call it, Operation, you know, Canton cover-up, okay? June 6th, I found myself being ordered to appear along with my wife at a deposition on 40 Broad Street, where Judge Krupp and Judge Casper ordered my wife to be deposed because they alleged that she was Miss Madoff. So Bernie and Mr. and Mrs. Madoff, that my wife was somehow financially connected to this $100 billion project. Lo and behold, we were at the law offices at Jesmer Updegrove. On a side note, Jesmer Updegrove has 8 attorneys that work directly for Thermo Fisher. The CEO of Thermo Fisher is married to Judge Casper. And at the 10:20 mark, my wife was being interrogated so much and being threatened so much if she didn't answer questions about the financials of the company, which she had no knowledge of. She had no idea about anything, that she would be jailed by Judge Krupp and held in contempt, similar to the same threats that were happening with Turtle Boy and Karen. And all of a sudden, my wife, through the complete stress of what was going on, went into cardiac arrest syndrome and dropped to the floor. Within 1 or 2 seconds, I was on my knees screaming, and this will be released. We have the recorded tapes of the assault and battery of that morning. As I was attending to my wife, trying to revive her, slapping her, shaking her, screaming, call 911, call 911. The attorney, seeing at this point his entire Operation Schoolhouse — we didn't know Operation Schoolhouse existed at the time of this incident — he ran around the table, went into the corner of the law office, and as I stood up to have him charge at me, he jumped and grabbed my coat and started to punch me and jumped on my back, of which I fell on my wife, and he kicked and flailed on the way down my wife, who was unconscious, only to have on recorded lines — we'll release these soon — the secretary who was in on it come into the law office conference room screaming, Kevin Peters, what are you doing? What are you doing? What is happening? Then screaming, oh, you're faking it, to my wife that was in cardiac arrest. You're faking it, Sean. Within another minute and a half, there were 12 Boston police, SWAT, ATF, SWAT gun car ambulances outside the law offices, and they attempted to turn around and frame me in a scheme called Operation Schoolhouse. Here's what happens next. As I rushed to the hospital, and which took — this is all on recorded lines — over 48 minutes, before an ambulance that was just outside the door of the law office to get the gurney upstairs to aid to my wife, they registered her heart on the way out the door after an hour at heartbeats at the 265 beats per minute. I followed the ambulance to Mass General, and my wife was admitted to intensive care for the next 3.5 days. Carl Dugall appears, calling me when I was by my wife's bedside while she was suffering from a cardiac arrest incident, and attempted to offer me a deal to not tell the story of what just happened. And it was explaining that he had already spoken with Kevin Peters. Kevin Peters was the former attorney at Todd and Weld. Kevin Peters was involved in, as a special prosecutor, in the Whitey Bulger murder plot and trial of the century. And their insistence, if I would not tell the truth about what happened, they would see it that Kevin Peters would not file charges against myself, where Carl Dugall attempted to extort the truth by saying, let's all forget about this. Let's pretend this never happened. Kevin Peters feels really bad. We're really sorry about your wife. But if you tell me now that you won't press charges against you won't press charges against Kevin Peters. We'll make sure he doesn't press charges against you, because Nick, it's felony one, because Kevin Peters is 61. You're facing felony charges. Now, during this whole conversation, I kept asking Carl Ducal over and over again, Carl, is this line being recorded? All lines are being recorded here at Precinct 1, Boston, Massachusetts. Okay, Carl, this line's recorded, right? Yes, it is. Yes, it is. So after he convinced me for 15 minutes, attempting to flip my story and cut a deal that I would not be prosecuted on felony one for allegedly attacking a senior citizen, he would see that Kevin Peters dropped the case against me. Dan Duquette gets involved a little bit later in the afternoon. I then turned around and said, absolutely not. Whoever may be listening, which was Mike Powers, that is another detective at the Precinct One. Mike Powers is the cousin of Clerk John Powers over at the Suffolk Superior Court that sits under Judge Krupp. And then they're related to Joe Powers in Howardsport, Massachusetts. That's the town manager that runs the local Howard Police Department that, if you know, framed me in the other incident in the August of 2023. I said, no, Carl, no, Mike Powers. I'm not going to drop anything. I want to press charges against Kevin Peters for the attack on my wife and myself. She almost died. I'm coming down right now to file charges at the Boston Precinct One, and I want to fill out a complaint, and I want the Boston police to send detectives as soon as my wife is out of the ICU to give her statements, because we're going to tell the truth about you, about what had happened, and about the frame. And I went down that afternoon to the Boston Precinct One police, and I started to fill out five different criminal complaints, not only against Kevin Peters, the attorney that attacked me, but against George Soros's operatives who had already threatened to kill me before, who already wiretapped me, who already loan sharked me, who already extorted me. Dan was involved in all this. I filled out five different police reports. And then I went and sat by my wife's bedside for the next 2.5 days and called 911 every hour on the hour, attempting to get a police officer from Boston police to take my wife's statements that she, in fact, was assaulted. No one ever came. No one ever showed up. No one ever bothered to do anything. My wife and I, knowing that I was going to be prosecuted, or we felt that I was being framed, after she got released from Mass General Hospital and Dan Duquette was involved and attorney Kevin Savage was involved, we took the courage to walk into the belly of the beast in Boston Precinct One. And my wife and I walked up to the desk and attempted to fill out three other police reports. I think Thursday of that week, the incident happened on June 6th, J6th, right here in Massachusetts. It has its own insurrection. It's J6th. And when we filled out the police reports, as we turned around, Sean, we had the highest brass in Boston police standing in front of us.
Now, this is what I ask you.
Yes.
You have receipts for this.
I have 100% irrefutable receipts of everything, and right, all the phone calls are recorded and submitted to the FBI as requested. Law enforcement in Howard Porch, Massachusetts, law enforcement in Waikiki Beach, law enforcement in Washington, D.C., law enforcement continued to tell me, because there was an ongoing criminal action and crimes taking place against me under the federal rules of regulation, I was to continue to record phone calls, because there were federal crimes happening, and I need not worry about Massachusetts wiretapping laws because of the federal crimes that were happening. I recorded everything, every phone call, every threat on my life, every judge, all of it.
Because that's important, Nikki, because, you know, in this day and age, right, especially in this world, you know, we have to verify. We have to verify. And if you have the receipts, we're going to continue this. Do you still have that warrant against you then? Is that what we're saying?
So we have what we understand. There are two warrants that the law says. So if you follow the rules, prior to each warrant being issued where they could bring this upon us, I removed both cases to the federal court. So on Christmas, no different than what they attempted to do. And we all know, no one wants to talk about how they framed Turtle Boy. with his estranged girlfriend. That was all a setup.
That is true. That is true. I mean, listen, guys, out there in the chat, you give him that credit.
Start talking about you got framed on Christmas, just like George in, you know, It's a Wonderful Life. Potter framed you. George Soros framed you. He framed me. So on December 22nd, 2022, I take you to Ted Daniels out front of the courthouse with his news trucks, waiting for me to show up where they were going to charge me on this bullshit warrant. And the charge, even though Kevin Peters in the secret courts, so we had a show cause hearing, the same show cause hearing, the secret courts in Massachusetts, it's the only courthouse in the country that has this secret court system where they go in front and you present your facts to a clerk magistrate. You covered in your tweet that the clerk magistrate, who no one knows where he is, his name is Lawler. Not to be confused with Lolly, this 28-year-old kid conducts a hearing. Sean, I want to step off and tell you what happened.
Hold on. Because this is what I want to get to.
Yes, sir.
Is Carl Dougal connected to Brian Albert?
100%. So Carl Dougal and Mike Powers, taking orders from Brian Albert, ran the Operation Schoolhouse frame of me on June 6th.
Okay.
So Carl Dougal is the first guy that calls me.
Can we commit to something? Okay.
Yes.
I'm gonna do my homework. Next Thursday, you want to do this next story.
I want you to announce it now because I'm gonna guarantee you're gonna break
the interview. Hold on. We're gonna do a deep dive into the controversial Operation Schoolhouse.
Yes.
Okay. Can we commit to that? Okay.
Yeah, we'll focus that heavily. I'll bring in the receipts, the recordings.
I'm gonna time slot this next Thursday, 7 o'clock, because a lot of people here have to. Turtle has his little his members only thing. I want to be respectful to him.
No one's over there listening to them because he's
Listen, all right, we're gonna keep it classy here. Okay,
Turtle, keep up the good fight. Just tell the whole truth and you'll be fine.
No, that's the whole thing. So listen, I promised the people in the chat tonight that. This would be controversial. I mean, let's face it, guys. There's a lot of stuff going on here. Give him respect, all right? This guy, life has, I can attest to it. He's running everywhere, okay? You have a credible, listen, Nikki's credible. He's credible. Nikki is a walking encyclopedia. He's a brain. He's a human data computer. But listen, just do me a favor. Right? Look at how respectful Dan Duquette is, and his involvement with Nikki. And I'm going to tell you, I'll be completely honest with you. If it wasn't for Dan Duquette, Nikki, you'd be down.
Turtle Boy, Soros has Turtle Boy's back, but just
all right, hold on now. Come on. Listen, we don't, if you have receipts, I want you to bring that, but we're not going to, I don't want to hear it.
I understand.
Listen, what I want is this. Okay. We're going to do a deep dive.
Yep.
Next Thursday.
June 6th.
One topic only.
Operation
Schoolhouse.
Okay. Yep.
Because I think these people here, since it's mostly a Karen Reed based, Turtle Boy based, the whole nine, we got the glare in. He might want to see you.
I love the glare.
Well, that's good. He's having a hard time with you. He's having a little hard time. I get it. I get it. Listen, how many times we have, I wouldn't say we had battles. But, you know, listen, Dan Duquette is the thread between us. He really is. He's the voice of reason.
He's the honest man in baseball. He just outed the corruption in Massachusetts.
Right.
And nobody on the chat rooms, especially Turtle Boy, can take away what is actually going on. Tell the whole truth and rebuild this country, Turtle Boy.
Okay.
And you'll save yourself in the interim, because when this is done, all Soros' operatives, I'm naming all the names with all the cash checks.
So we're
going on the right side of this thing.
We're going to table this next Thursday night. I'm going to stop promoting it now. I want to get some things from you, though, Nikki. I want to have the goods. We're going to do a deep dive. We're going to put receipts on the table, recordings, whatever. I'll figure it out.
Can we have Olivia help a little bit? Because this is so important, because we already know yesterday, and Turtle Boy did a good job. You know, Sean, I think there were 7 or 8 media outlets that were outside when Turtle Boy left, and they only asked one question.
And what was that?
Now, they only asked Turtle Boy one question. So there were 7 or 8 media outlets there. He comes out of the courthouse steps. Tim Bradle, who I worked with a little bit, he's involved in the narrative. We got the receipts on him. He's a good guy because he's going to do the right thing when it comes time to tell the whole truth.
Right.
But out of the 7 media outlets, only one reporter asked Turtle Boy a question. Well, why didn't they ask him any other questions from any other media outlets? Because those media outlets were assuming he was going to be jailed again, because in order to keep him quiet, they needed to lock him back up.
So you're talking about today. You're talking about today.
Listen, you had media trucks, a media storm, protesters,
right. Sure.
And they're all lined up clamoring in front of Turtle Boy. And he walks out and one beautiful woman of truth asked one question. All the other news cameras didn't ask him because they're spinning the narrative. Okay. Turtle Boy was supposed to get locked up, but somebody down there, that judge has a little bit of justice left in her.
Good. And that's
we're going to leave this kid on the outside for a little bit longer. Don't mess it up, Turtle Boy. Start telling the whole truth.
Okay, let's hope this goes away quickly. But listen, Nikki, I want to give you a special thanks. I mean, it's not easy coming on. I'm telling you, and it's not easy.
Could I ask you and other mods just to post the link?
I'm going to do it on all my platforms.
I want everyone to be educated because we're putting together a entire army of truth seekers in Massachusetts.
You were putting up airplanes, weren't you? You were putting airplanes.
Yes, I flew multiple airplanes. I brought trucks around.
All those airplanes with the tags. Okay, listen, Nikki.
I'm going to do it again. But Sean, what I want to tell you is, and a lot of people on the chat, it's difficult to follow all this. If you head over to Unsilent Majority 1222 on YouTube, you can press the two recordings. One's 28 minutes and one is 12 minutes that explains everything.
Oh, thank God. So that's
Unsilent Majority 1222. Can you have your mods post that in the chat?
I will. But something,
Unsilent Majority 1222 in YouTube. You're everyone can get educated and then go to the website gottruthamerica.com. Or Sean, you know what the funny thing is?
No, I want to say there's actually still 12 minutes just with you that I can't find that hard to believe. But
no, it is. It had over 1 million hits in the North Korean, like say no to the CCP. I'm famous in China because I've exposed the deep state with the Chinese partnering. The key is though, God, Truth, America, or for those, Sean, we didn't even talk about Whitey Bulger. We can also
stop.
How do you forget Whitey Bulger, Sean?
Stop. All right.
We'll get into that after.
That's going to be like 3 weeks down the road. You're killing me. All right. Listen, we're going to commit to Operation Schoolhouse because I really believe this is going to bring you back. All right. I would say, listen, it was probably 75% is with you. And listen, I expect 25% or more. It doesn't matter. The bottom line is this.
Whoever's not with the truth are Soros operatives. I'll prove every single thing of it. And for your listeners, this is the shortest stream you've ever done, but it's the most informative.
I'll tell you why. Even myself, all right, we get into overload. You get into overload, right? And you have so much. You living this, all right?
I am living every day.
Even myself, all right? I did this for a living, taking debriefings. And you're a hard guy. You got to be, put the saddle on you and broken. But listen, I want to give you a platform. Dan Duquette, yourself, I'm so happy you came on. I need a volume to
Yep, Sean, our intention, I talked to Wayne Root.
They know me. I need a value. Lisa C., I need a value. I need a lot more than a value.
So I already
want to start drinking, for Christ's sake.
Don't do that.
I've been shitting you.
Actually, what really benefited me is when J. Michael Doyle started drinking because he really started spilling the beans on how
Listen, Nick, I want to appreciate you coming on. Yes. This took a while to do. I told the people this is going to be very controversial. I did not lie, okay? And like I said, I want to give you your voice. Dan Duquette brings it to a different level, okay?
Yep.
But next week, Thursday, whatever date that is, 7 o'clock, we're going to do a deep, deep dive.
Into Sean, I talked to Wayne Allen Root.
Yes.
I was right there with the president.
You were. Colorado,
and we're going to bring you on next week, and you're going to be an investigative reporter without Turtle Boy's, you know, Soros hooks.
Listen,
from behind any lines.
Listen, Turtle Riders. All right, listen.
It's the truth. Just tell the rest of the story. Who does Hamburger or Meatball work for? Who does Albert's work for? You think they're doing this because of someone on their front lawn?
We're hoping.
They're covering for something much
we're
bigger.
We're hoping on March 20th, when we get those incredible Rule 17 motions front and center, all right, we're going to find a lot. But we're going to.
John, I want to say I love Turtle Boy. I just want him to finish the story.
Okay, so and you know something? I know he will. Listen, he did 60 days. He definitely took a hit for the team. Come on.
That Soros gave him a little kiss. He said, you better continue to do what I tell you.
That's
how powerful this guy is.
Okay. Well, listen, Nick.
He'll be in the book anyways when he writes
I've done this like 20 times to get you off. I want to give
I'm still the shortest stream in the history of your stream. This is the fourth one.
I know, because you know why? Okay. You're so important. Before you leave. I want to thank you, all right? We have to give a little taste, all right?
Yeah.
And but I thank you for coming on. We're going to do this again next Thursday night, Operation Schoolhouse, which is going to be incredible because I've read it. I know he has the receipts. Todd right there, this guy, Todd, he's a big fan. He knows personally your buddy, Wayne Root, whatever his name is.
Alan Root? Wayne is a big deal.
Listen, Nicky, again, be safe out there.
Trust me.
It's dangerous.
And let me a little note to all the CIA operatives. I see you guys coming a miles away. my wife is probably watching. Maybe she's not. I mean, when a Russian 6-foot supermodel, good thing I've got one at home, tries to approach me, every other day,
gets a little tired. Okay.
Come on, CIA. You can do better than
that. Okay. Listen, thank you again.
America, everybody.
Buddy. We'll talk tomorrow. Okay. Thank
good
you.
Night.
All right. Bye bye. Well, I got to tell you, he doesn't disappoint. All right. I knew this was going to be controversial. All right. I did. I knew that certain topics would, in fact, I knew certain topics that would come out would be a little delicate, all right? The part about Turtle Boy came from left field. I like I said, I got my disclaimer there. Whatever these people are saying, it does not represent my thoughts, all right? Or the team, my team of mods, who I think are doing a great job. I got to admit, all right, he is exhausting because I'll tell you, he's a guy that's on a mission. He is. And like I said, if it wasn't for Dan Duquette, I couldn't do this. I wouldn't be able to do it with a straight face. And I will say, I think most of the stuff he's talking about, because he has the motions, he does have receipts. He has recordings. I've listened to the recordings. So I just want to give everyone my sincere gratitude for hanging in. We have, almost 4,885 people. So maybe we can, if you guys want to open up for a couple of comments, let me talk to you about what's happening on March 20th. All right. I've got a little breakdown. It appears that the phone records or the third party records that Team Karen Reed is going for are the all important burner accounts. Okay. Between Proctor, between Brian Albert, Brian Higgins, and now Chief Berkowitz. All right. We now know those conversations definitely exist. They're not going to take only 10 minutes. They're going to be given a full hearing. And I'm sure, like we saw with when Liz Proctor's attorney had to get up, well, they're going to have their attorneys get up and fight this. But I believe that the defense received information that's locked, that's rock solid, and that they're going to be able to give these records back to the defense. And we're going to find out exactly who was calling who. Maybe they got the text on the all-important time frames of the morning of January 29th, 2022. So let me see if I can take any questions here. Yeah, Todd, we have the burner accounts. I believe those are going to be the burner accounts. And that was what, you know, let's face it. If this wasn't a cover up, right, Michael Proctor and company would be doing exactly what the FBI did, right? These guys didn't do a thing. Now they're going to try to hide behind the fact that, well, we didn't have any other suspects. Well, they didn't have any other suspects because they didn't do a real investigation, right? They never looked for other suspects because they did a targeted based investigation. They had their person. They just had to invent. Like I said, the car is out. That means all the evidence that came from the car is out. The DNA, the particles on John's clothing, it's gone, right? So contrary to other podcasters want to say, well, there isn't many out there. There's only one or maybe two. This case is done, all right? And as much as Auntie Bev wants to see this go through, Morrissey has to buckle. He's going to have to buckle, all right? So what else is here? Trying to think. Now, Mike Bradford, you are definitely biased, but you're a good guy. And yes, it is eye-opening. And I knew this. And I talked to my people here about how controversial this would be. I don't think I've ever put a disclaimer down there before. But listen, everyone has a story. And if we get 10% of the truth, we're doing pretty good. All right. We know corruption exists. We know Karen Reed has been living in corruption hell. That guy is living in corruption hell. The guy coming on Saturday evening is in corruption hell. And listen, I want to let everyone know, I have transitioned from Team Karen Reed, right? You know, the justice for Karen and John and Karen, to a corruption-based platform. I want to get all the corruption there is that is coming down into my hands. I've got a ton of it. So don't be too hard on me because I'm not talking 100% Karen Reed. Karen Reed, all right, anybody who knows me and my dedication to the Karen Reed movement knows that I am 1,000,000% behind Karen Reed and her innocence. And, you know, I was pretty upset last night. I got to tell you, 35 years, all right, as a law enforcement officer, I told Kevin Lenihan on his show, and he asked me to think about this question. He said, he asked me two questions, the highlight of my career and the low light of my career. And the question that I answered about the low light of my career, the low light of my career, the down of my career was this case. And I had been already retired 11, 12 years by this time. This case brought me down. I'm embarrassed to say that I worked for to being a police officer, to be in law enforcement, to see what these animals did and covered up. And with the help of, now we know, Chief Berkowitz, someone had to have the juice to get people to, like I said, to obey, right? Someone had to have that juice. How far up the chain does it go? We'll find out. But yes, and like I said, this is going to be a corruption-based platform, and it will definitely, trust me, I'm never abandoning the Karen Reed movement, the Karen Reed case. But I just want to open up a little bit to show that other people are living in corruption hell. I call it corruption hell. So what else? I want to see what other questions we have here. Okay, who was BA really working for, right? Okay, I mean, we're going to, listen, the one thing is we are going to find out, all right? I am 100% sure that the FBI knows. I would gather to know that the FBI knows, right, who had enough power to have these people ruin their careers and possibly put them in jail for many, many years. Someone had to have that juice. But they never suspected that the FBI was on their coattails, right? They never factored that in. This would have been all over with, right? They probably would have had the case dismissed on purpose. Karen would have beat the charges and everyone would have been gone home. Karen would have depleted all her funds, right? But now we know that Karen, from the very first, from the very beginning, said she was going to mount a third-party culprit defense to not only clear her, clearing her is not enough. Showing, getting justice for John, getting the animals, think about this, the animals who beat him and dropped him out front of that house to die in the most heinous way any police officer could ever die, like trash, at the hands of other police officers and at the covering of other police officers. This has got to be the most embarrassing, the most disgusting, the most heinous act of cruelty. I don't even have the words for this, but anyways. So 2 weeks tomorrow, we got over 5,000 people watching this over the three platforms. I know you guys want to get over to see Turtle. Trust me, this thing with Nikki and Turtle, that's their thing. That has nothing to do with me. I have no idea what the hell Nikki's talking about anything. I know the kid, Turtle, took a hit, 60 days being in jail. Who the hell wants that, all right? So, like I said, if you're interested, come back next Thursday. I'm going to have a deep dive on this case with him. I'm going to keep it specific to this Operation Schoolhouse. It has to come up because it definitely deals with Carl Dougal and Brian Albert. And he's got documents. He's got the actual radio communications when these guys are talking. And Will, for the Clara, this one I know he has the receipts for. I've heard the tapes. That's going to be must see, because this is going to show the corruption, the level that these people went after when they have the right tools and the wrong mindset. Listen, I will respect a guy, a thug, a criminal who puts a gun to a guy's head, right, and robs him, all right, versus a dirty cop. You got a cop with a badge who's dirty is the worst person you can ever have. So with that said, I'm about at the spent level. I've been going strong since Sunday. We did Sunday, Monday, Tuesday with, what's his name? Wales, alternate corner with my buddy Dylan Davies. Yesterday, tonight, taking tomorrow off. Going to come back on Saturday with another controversial. It's more controversial for me personally because it involves people that I work with. Actually worked with some of these people that are going to be talked about. So, yeah, Todd, I got to take a breath. I got to do it. But no rants tonight. No rants. That's a good thing. No rants. I'm ranted out, maybe. And a big thank you to the mods out there. It's not easy. I didn't really see any really controversial Jamaica. Jamaica will come there, big dog, big old dog. Jamaica will come. All right. We're going to hold that in the bag. Maybe, you know, we'll see what happens. Hold the phone. The all-important story about John's niece and Jen McCabe and Peggy, I'm having the person, this is breaking news, I'm having that person come on, right? It's her story to tell. She's going to tell the story. She also has another story that she's reported, but I'm going to keep it back. But that's right, Care Bear. Big Daddy's in the... I have no idea where that came out of, Big Daddy. But I will have that woman. She's a woman, and she's going to tell that story because she lived in the neighborhood. She saw with her very own eyes what was going on in that neighborhood. This is before they moved. They were all living in Ponkapunk. You know, you had all the players, Jen, you had Carrie, right? You had poor John, you know. He moved into the house where his sister and his brother-in-law, where the kids were. So they moved in there, and they saw all the little movements that the neighbors were making, Jen was making. Trust me, she had a thing for John. And it was very awesome. But that's her story. She's going to come on and tell it. I just don't know how I can get her in, but it's on the plate. It's in the working. So, with that said, Will, thank you for being here. Will, all my mods, thank you for all the stuff you do. All the regulars, I see Heidi out there. I see Scott McGinnis, man. He's everywhere. He's probably over in Turtle's thing now, his private event. But Jay Burke, another patriot. It's all good. It really is. It's all good because you know why? We're going to expose it and we're not going to correct it. But if we just make a little dent, we're better off for it. So thank you again. What time is it? 9:19. I went over my time limit, but I hope you enjoyed it. It's a little controversial, but we'll see what happens next week. Thanks a lot, guys. I hope I see you Saturday at 6 o'clock, and we'll tee it off from there. Everyone have a good night. Stay safe. Stay corrupted free. You don't need to end up in any corruption here. Okay. Everyone, good night. Galera, thanks for stopping in. Mike Bradford, great guy. Let's get out of that stupid Canton 8 thing. You guys need to be free. You guys need to be free. Joey Just Saying, another great guy. H-Bag, as always. And we're good to go. Guys, thanks a lot. You guys are beautiful. Look at this, 5,168 people at sign-off. Adios, amigos.